Good afternoon. Welcome to those who are gathered here in our beautiful sanctuary. Welcome to those who are watching us via Facebook and YouTube. This is our annual cemetery decoration service, when we remember and give thanks for those who have finished their earthly time in our midst and rest now in eternity. It's a little bit different than our November All Saints service. At that time, we name all those who have passed away, but here today, we will name those who have been blessed by Trinity's ministry and now rest in Trinity Cemetery and Union Cemetery since the last decoration service. With that in mind, we will say those beloved names once again out loud and give thanks by lighting a candle in their memory. Carolyn Gerhardt. Dorothy Leibold. Charlie Becker. John Miller. Jim Hennig. Gerald Schenk. Jerry Bouvet. Edna Grine. Ron Herman. Dean Becker. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the family and friends we remember today, for the love we shared and the memories we hold. Our lives are forever changed by their lives. Sometimes they seem so close we can almost touch them. Grant peace to every heart that hurts, and let your love fill our lives every day. Give us faith to believe we will be reunited one day, where pain and tears and death are no more. Direct us in whatever good we try to do with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name. And finally, by your mercy, bring us all to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 779, On Eagle's Wings.
Thank you.
Please be seated for the readings.
The readings for the 14th Sunday after Pentecost Cemetery Decoration Service is a reading from the prophet Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 to 11. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. So I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. He said, "Can I not do with you, Israel, as this potter does?" declares the Lord. "Like clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, Israel. If at any time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, and if that nation I warned repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster I had planned. And if at another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I intended to do for it. Now therefore, say to the people of Judah and those living in Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says. Look, I am preparing a disaster for you and devising a plan against you. So turn from your evil ways, each one of you, and reform your ways and your actions." A reading from Psalm 139, starting at verse 1. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Open your eyes and hear God's word. Open your heart.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 14th chapter. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "Whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." This is the Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
They who have ears to hear the message, they who have ears, now let them hear. They who would learn the way of wisdom, let them hear God's word. God has spoken to the people. Alleluia. God has spoken words of wisdom. Alleluia. God has spoken to the people. Alleluia. God has spoken words of wisdom.
For those of you who have lost loved ones, this might be the first time you've entered back into this sacred space. And I just want to acknowledge that that takes courage. Others find God's presence here every week, yet they too hurt and continue to miss their family and friends. When we talk about death, it's seldom with total happiness. There's mystery, there's fear, there's dread. Where are they now? Did they make it to heaven? Will I ever see them again? But we're not here to talk about death today. We are here to receive hope and to celebrate the good news, which is why Psalm 139 is so helpful for our time of reflection. Sometimes, I have to confess, I just want to run away. I want to run away from my responsibilities. I want to run away from my mistakes. I want to run away from my stresses. I want to run away from all the negativity that's constantly around me. Sometimes I am so done with the news and with social media, with my family, and with all other people. I'm just done. Maybe the rest of you never feel that way. Maybe you never worry about stuff. Maybe you are happy, happy, happy all the time. There is a children's story that was written in 1942 by Margaret Wise Brown entitled The Runaway Bunny, and maybe some of you know this story. The Runaway Bunny, it tells a story about a little bunny who wanted to run away. So he says to his mom, "I'm running away." And his mother replies, "If you run away, I will run after you, for you are my little bunny." And the little bunny replies, "Well, if you run after me, I'm going to become a fish in a trout stream, and I'll swim away from you." To which the mother replied, "If you become a fish in a trout stream, I will become a fisherman, and I will fish for you." And the little bunny said, "Well, if you become a fisherman, I will become a rock on a mountain high above you." And his mother said, "If you become a rock on a mountain high above me, I will be a mountain climber, and I will climb to where you are." And the story continues in this vein, with the little bunny trying to run away by various means, and his mother saying she would do whatever was necessary to find him.
And there's something about that story that's so compelling, isn't there? We don't know whether the little bunny is mad at his mom and trying to punish her for something that she did, which kids do all the time, right? Or if he's being saucy and he needs a bop on his cottontail bottom. Or whether he's just really having a bad day and he wants nothing more than to be left alone. Maybe this is his first attempt at running away. Maybe he's done this before and he knows exactly how it will all end. But I think it's fair to say that most of us have experienced this in our faith journey. And if it hasn't happened to you yet, hang on, because it probably will. At some point in our lifetime, most of us try to run away from God for various reasons and for various lengths of time. Many of us find we don't really need God because we're doing just fine on our own, thank you very much. Money, education, good health, all things that we've worked for and things that we take credit for. Many of us run away from God because we're mad at him. He hasn't answered our prayers like we expected him to. Many of us run away because we've been hurt by people in the church. God isn't the kind of guy we want to hang out with, to be judged unfairly by and to be doomed to eternal damnation like so many faithful people have assured us will happen. Many of us think being a follower of Jesus doesn't make logical, science-based sense. Life is just too busy to be bothered by some far-off, long-bearded God sitting on a cloudy throne. And so the story of the little runaway bunny is as old as history itself. It's our story. It's a story that's at the center of our Bibles. Remember Adam and Eve? They tried hiding in the bushes, in the garden, hiding from God who created them, running from the love and relationship God desired for him. What happened there? God comes walking through the garden, searching for them, finding them, changing his plans for their lives, but providing for them in their new life. And remember Jonah? God gave him a job to do, and he didn't like it. So he tried to run away, and he got on a ship. The Bible says he went west, away from the presence of God. But God found him in the belly of a whale and set him back on the road he'd been created to follow. Last week, we talked about the parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin. And within those two parables, we found the love of God is like the shepherd who always goes in search of the lost sheep, those who have run away, or those whose circumstances led them to wander off. And when he finds them, there is great joy in heaven. Remember that? And a party. So there's a lot of comfort in these sacred stories then, isn't there? It might sound kind of creepy, like God's ready to pounce on us from behind a magical curtain, but the spirit of Psalm 139 isn't fear, it's trust. The trust that nothing can separate us from the loving presence of God. As Paul writes in Romans chapter 8, I am convinced that neither life nor death, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Wherever we go, whatever happens to us, God is there. And there, wherever there is, God knows us through and through. He knows what we think. He knows what we do. He knows what we say, even before we do. He loves us enough to pay attention to us, moment by moment, like a parent cares about a child. He knows about our struggles. He knows about our questions. He knows about our joys, and he knows about our grief. And still, he never tires of running after us and finding us and loving us back into his arms. Where can I go? Where can I hide? Nowhere. At the end of The Runaway Rabbit, the mother speaks of catching the little bunny in her arms and holding him fast and hugging him with a love so profound, so powerful, so tried and tested and trustworthy that nothing can separate that runaway bunny from his mother's love. And so, exhausted by the mother's relentless promise to run after him and find him, the little bunny says, "Well, I might just as well stay where I am and be your little bunny." Which is how it is with God's love, right? His inescapable presence is a gift to us if only we just stop running. We call it grace, God's love made known to us in Jesus Christ. And in that grace, we find all the hope and all the good news that we need to last a lifetime and beyond. So let's sing our next hymn, number 770, "I Was There to Hear Your Morning Cry."
Thank you.
We use the words of the Apostles' Creed to confess the faith in which we live. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the prayers. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. We pray for our bishops, Susan and Michael, and communities of faith around the world. Refresh the hearts of your people. Deepen our understanding of every good thing we have, and strengthen our partnerships in the faith. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the well-being of the earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, and for streams and other bodies of water, God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nations and those in authority, for elected leaders of our towns, provinces, and countries, and for international organizations, grant wisdom to those who govern and raise up citizens who make decisions in the best interest of their neighbors. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, those who struggle with homelessness or food insecurity, for those whose family life is difficult, and for all this community who need your care. Especially we pray for Tammy, Pastor Christine, Laverne, Phyllis, and Guy. We pray for all who continue to look after us during the pandemic, all who wait for tests, results, and treatments, and all those we name in our hearts. God of grace, hear our prayer. For this community of faith, for all our labors begun, continued, and ended in you, that they may glorify your holy name. Bless your people with the strength to live into their many vocations for the sake of the world. We mourn with the people of the James Smith Cree Nation, and all those who continue to suffer from the abuses of colonization and residential schools. We give thanks for the life and work of Reverend Lloyd Wiseman. We give thanks for the life and work of Queen Elizabeth II and pray for her family at their time of grief. Grant them all peace in their eternal rest, comfort for their families, and joy in their rising again in glory. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gather together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. As we gather around this table of grace, where mysteriously and miraculously and by the grace of God, our ancestors also gather. We remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered together by the Holy Spirit, we pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the banquet where all are welcome. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This has been a beautiful time of worship together. Thank you all for coming. I know that many of you will be visiting the cemetery and your loved ones directly following the service, but I'd like to just make one more announcement, and that is to remind you that our next generation of Christ followers are set to return next Sunday, September 18th, when Sunday school begins again. Children will come for the beginning of worship, and then they will depart for their classes during the sermon, and parents can pick them up at the end of service. And I have it on very good authority that next Sunday, we might just be starting coffee fellowship again. Woohoo! Can I get a woohoo? I'll say. So if you have children or grandchildren that are ready to get started, next Sunday at 10 o'clock is the time, and Trinity is the place. As we leave this place, receive this gift. God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen. Our sending hymn is number 377, Lift High the Cross.
Thank you.
Go in peace with Christ beside you. Thanks be to God.